Well, good morning all. Good morning and welcome to our worship, and a special welcome to any who are visiting with us at this time. At the close of our worship, for those that wish to stay, we have a brief celebration of Holy Communion, and for others there are refreshments served outside the West Hall. You'll see there that Judy and I leave tomorrow, heading for Vancouver, and in my absence, the services are going to be conducted by Carsten Decker and then Martin Fair. Martin is coming back for a holiday with his wife, Elaine. So Carsten will conduct worship on the next two Sundays and then Martin Fair. Could I just add that, having intimated at the annual general meeting that I'll be retiring at the end of April next year, I'm now being asked fairly regularly, well, when can we start looking for a new minister, right? It's out with the old and in with the new. Right. And I have to indicate to you that nothing very much happens until I leave. Such are the processes of the Church of Scotland. So only after I leave that the process of finding a new minister begins. And the reason I say that is just to, you know, emphasize, Martin is not here for a job interview, right? Right. He's here on holiday with his wife, but I'm delighted that he was more than happy to conduct worship on that first Sunday in August. So let us worship God in singing to his praise hymn 127, O Worship the King, all glories above. The grass may wither, the flower fade, but the word of our God will endure forever. Let us pray. Almighty God, we gather this day to offer you our worship and our praise. We come from our different homes, with our different backgrounds and stories, but united in our worship of you, and united with your whole church in heaven and on earth, as we acknowledge you as creator and sustainer of all life. For in love you have created all that is, and in love you sustain it. And through Christ and the workings of your Holy Spirit, you seek to redeem it. And we confess that we look at a world and lives in need of redemption. We look with sadness and horror at the violent deaths of young people in our own community here in Bermuda. We look at so much suffering in this, your world, and the rule and the abuse of power and oppression. And yet we live in a world of great beauty. The great oceans, the marvelous mountain ranges, the deserts and plains, and the great diversity of life. Your gift of a great biodiversity, and your gift of human diversity. And yet, too often, we fail to celebrate that diversity and see it in human terms as a cause of great division. And so, before you now, we ask forgiveness. Forgiveness, personally, for the wrongs that we have done, and corporately as a church for not failing up to the task given to us. We ask the forgiveness of those we have hurt with a cruel word or a lack of response and action when they needed our help and support. And as we ask your forgiveness, we ask also their forgiveness and patience with us. And grant us, we pray, the assurance of that forgiveness, that we might be freed from these faults and failings of the past and the guilt that accompanies them. May this day be a new day, the beginning of a new week, when we put aside time to seek to listen to your word for each one of us and to ourselves as a church, as a congregation. Help us to discern the promptings of your Spirit, to follow the paths down which you call us, to lead us closer to you, for in so doing, we will become closer to one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We sing from the Psalms, and at hymn number 52, Psalm 84, and at hymn 52, How lovely is thy dwelling place, O Lord of hosts, to me.
Thank you.
As we continue our readings from the Gospel of St. Mark, I have to say a not very cheery reading for such a beautiful summer's day.
Good morning. Hear the word of God proclaimed in the New Testament. The reading is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 6, from verses 14 to 29. You'll find it on page 40 in the New Testament section of the Bible in the pews. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead. And for this reason, these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah. And others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in a prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and had wanted to kill him, but she could not. For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests, and his king said to the girl, ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it. And he solemnly swore to her, whatever you ask me, I'll give you, and even half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what should I ask for? She replied, the head of John the Baptizer. Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. May God bless the reading of his holy word, and to his name be glory and praise.
Number 600, Spirit of God, unseen as the wind, gentle as is the dove. Hymn 600.
Thank you.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. For such a beautiful summer's day, I did warn you that the reading for today was just rather gruesome. Mark's recounting of the death of John the Baptist. Mark, in telling the story, makes the point that Herod was aware of the work that Jesus was doing, the ministry that that he was doing, the healing of the sick, the gathering of the crowds, and in his own thinking asks himself, is this John the Baptizer or John the Baptist raised from the dead? And others say, no, it's Elijah or it's a prophet. But it gives the opportunity of Mark to go back a bit and then tell the story of the death, of the beheading of John the Baptist, a story that we need to sort of put in its context. The Herod, the King Herod that's referred to here, is Herod Antipas. And he was one of the sons of the great King Herod, who had ruled the area for some 40 years and died round about 4 BC. And he had three sons, and one of them, Herod Antipas, was appointed what's called a tetrarch of the area of Galilee and across the Jordan. And the first thing we need to know about all these characters, Herod himself and as his sons, is that they were appointed by the Roman authorities. They had their authority from them, and they tended to work with the powerful elite in their own area. And what they all had in common was that they were brutal. They were given pretty much a free hand by the Roman authorities as long as they maintained peace in that area and ensured that taxes were collected and returned to the Roman state. And what, in a sense, that means is that Herod Antipas had a free hand to do what he liked with this man, John the Baptist, whom he had imprisoned. And he had imprisoned him because Herod Antipas had married Herodias, who had been the wife of his brother or half-brother. And John the Baptizer, or Baptist, spoke out against this because it was contrary to the laws of Judaism that he be able to do this. So he was overtly critical of this public figure, Herod Antipas, for what he had done, spoke out against it. And the person who was most offended by this and most put out by what John the Baptist was saying was Herodias, his wife. So she held a tremendous grudge against John the Baptist for all that he was proclaiming, and because of that, Herod Antipas had him imprisoned. It's curious reading the story that it says that Herod Antipas was somewhat intrigued by John the Baptist. He regarded him as a righteous man, and he liked to listen to him, to hear what he had to say. See, it is intriguing to think that this Herod Antipas, this brutal governor, would actually spend time with John the Baptist in prison and listen to him. Is it an indication that despite his terrible abuse of power, despite his brutality, despite indeed the very person that he was, that there was something in him, that drew him to what John the Baptist was saying? And he certainly was content just to hold him in prison because he was somewhat fearful of him, recognizing that he was indeed a righteous man and that he had the great followers of the crowds. This is a story which you'll already have seen does not have Jesus in it at all. It's purely a story of Herod and John the Baptist. And then we're told it was Herod's birthday, and so he was going to have a party. And whom does he invite? He invites all the important people within his retinue, and indeed the leaders, the local leaders of the area of Galilee. One gets the suspicion, I mean, one cannot read too much into the text, but one gets the suspicion that this would be a gathering, a party, mainly of men. And so in the midst of that, he invites Salome, not Herodias, which Mark gets wrong in the text. We know from other sources and from other gospels that it wasn't Herodias that was invited to dance, it was Salome. In art and in literature, Salome of the Seven Veils. So it's Salome who's invited to dance, who in probability was a daughter of Herodias from the previous marriage. So a stepdaughter of Herod Antipas. And he gets her to dance before his assembled guests. And all are so taken with this that he asks, well, what would you like? What would you like as a reward? Saying grandly, you know, kind of boastful figure, even I'll give you half my kingdom. The arrogance of the man that he felt he could do that. And Herodias sees her opportunity. And so her daughter Salome asks her mother, what should I ask for? And Herodias says, the head of John the Baptist. And it would seem that Salome is not altogether an innocent kind of partner in this. Is she being abused in a way? Is she being taken advantage of? Difficult to say. But what we do know is that she then added, when she goes to Herod, she said, yes, I want the head of John the Baptist delivered on a platter. And so John is beheaded, and his head on a platter is presented and given to Herodias. It's a gruesome tale. It's brutal. And what it illustrates, of course, for us is the brutality that human beings can degenerate to, and especially those who are in a position of power and virtually absolute power. And we've seen it through history, and we see it in the world today. Is there anything good in the story? Is there anything good in the story? Well, it seemed to me that what is good in the story is that some of John's disciples go and ask Herod for the body of John the Baptist. Now, just put that in context, given the sort of person that Herod Antipas was, and they're going to him, this man that he's beheaded, he cares nothing of. They go to him and say, can we have his body? It would take a degree of courage to do that, to go and face up to this man and say, can we have his body? To show their loyalty to him. As an aside, it's interesting that didn't happen with Jesus' disciples at his death. It's Joseph of Arimathea that goes and retrieves Jesus' body. But does it remind you of anything? It reminded me of, in more recent times, the death of the Russian dissident Navalny, who was kept in horrible prison conditions, probably tortured, suffered hugely in prison, and eventually died in prison in unknown circumstances. And if you remember, his mother was not even able, not allowed to go and retrieve his body, and had to fight hard to be able to do that. And eventually his body was retrieved, and he was buried, and crowds turned out to support him, to be there at his funeral, despite the threat and the danger to their own lives in doing that. In modern day Russia, with the sort of power that Vladimir Putin has at his disposal. And yet they had the courage to stand up and show their loyalty and their belief in all that Navalny was doing. And maybe that's the element of hope in this gruesome story. And one other thing, which on my part is a flight of fancy. I don't know if you'll follow the thinking behind this or not. But do you remember? Some will remember that in the middle of the last century, the English historian Arnold Toynbee wrote a study of history in 12 volumes from 1934 to 1961, and it was a winner. Maybe not all 12 volumes. There was an abridged version, but it was very much in vogue at the time, and then completely fell out of fashion. And there are very good reasons for that. I think some of what he was saying betrays a perspective that would not be welcome, certainly in today's world. But his history, his study of history, was about the decline and fall of civilization. You know, how does it happen? How do civilizations arise, and how do they decline? And he mapped the rise and decline of some 20-odd civilizations throughout history, which I'm not going to name. But there are a number of civilizations that have just come and gone and are no more. I suppose the one we're most familiar with is, you know, the Roman Empire. You know, the great power that it wielded rose to prominence and is no more. And he had a theory as to why civilizations declined. And it was because they became self-satisfied. They arose, he postulated, because of challenges that were being faced. And a minority, which he described as a creative minority, that's the concept he used, a creative minority were able to respond to the particular challenges and go in a direction which was successful and which attracted others to it, and so that particular civilization developed. But that creative minority became a dominant minority that used power to dominate the civilization, the society of which they were a part, and to oppress others that were not part of it. And Toynbee suggested that eventually that civilization became self-satisfied and had within it, as a result, the roots of its own decline. And it would decline. And in its decline, and in the challenge of that decline, and in the crisis that that was creating, a new and different creative minority would arise. And history seems to demonstrate that this creative minority seemingly always goes on to become a dominant minority. It seeks to universalize. There's no room for difference in that society, for different faiths, for different cultures. It's got to be standardized, universal. And again, it falls into decline. And another creative minority arises. And what was at the back of my mind was this. In our own time, when the church in the West has become very much a minority, is it being called to become a creative minority in the midst of society? And just briefly, thinking of the position of the Church of Scotland in terms of a creative minority becoming a dominant minority and part of that. Back at the beginning of the 20th century, there was a huge ecumenical conference in Edinburgh, and the goal of that conference was to Christianize the whole world. Now, that's an aspect of a dominant minority, if you like. There's no room for anything else. There's not room for other religions, other faiths, other cultures. And that's gone. And that's recognized for what it was, and that is gone. But far more recently, I would say about 20 years ago, at the General Assembly of the Church of Scotland, the question was raised, should the Church of Scotland continue to be the national Church of Scotland, with all that goes with that? And that's its place, its relationship with the state. It's all the pomp and ceremony that goes with the General Assembly. It's a position that other denominations do not have. It's very much part of a dominant part of society. And the response at that time, 20 years ago, was, we have no desire to depart from that. And my suspicion is that that was a mistake which is coming home to roost now, with the minority position that the church, like others, find itself in Western society. And perhaps instead, what the church should be focusing on is that task of being a creative minority within society. But a creative minority, not as history has shown, that seeks power, but seeks to influence in a different sort of way, that stays loyal to its traditions and its teachings, but has the humility to respect the faith and the teachings and the cultures of others. Not to overcome them, and not to insist that you have to be like us. And so a creative minority that has at its roots not the lust and the desire for power, but shows the illustration of compassion and humility, and is a blessing on other peoples that do not share the same faith or culture. That the church, above all, can be that. It can be, as a creative minority within the society which exists, a blessing on that society through humility, loyalty to what it stands for, and compassion and graciousness. It may be that that's a stretch too far, but it's what I did manage to get out of this gruesome story of the beheading of John the Baptist. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to sing a hymn which reflects on our commitment to our own societies, but also our commitment to a different country and its values and its priorities. Hymn 704, I vow to thee, my country. As I indicated in the opening prayer, it's been a dreadful few days or weeks in here in Bermuda, with the violent deaths of so many, and leading people to question what on earth is going on this island, and which certainly needs to change. But in our prayers this morning, we will remember those who have been most deeply affected, the families, the loved ones of the deaths of those that we have lost in recent days. Let us offer our prayers of thanksgiving and our prayers for others. Let us pray. Almighty God, we give thanks for all your gifts and blessings to us in life, for the gift of life itself and all that enriches and enhances it, the opportunities before us each day. We give thanks for the love that surrounds and sustains us, the love of family and friends, the fellowship of your church. And above all, we give thanks this day for the life of Christ and his example of humility and service, of compassion and grace. The ways not of the world, but of your ways. And your desire that we follow in those very ways and enjoy that blessing and be in time too a blessing to others. And it is in Christ's name that we offer now our prayers for others. We pray for those who have lost loved ones in recent days. Those in natural circumstances, those that were dear friends, but here in our midst, those that have suffered violent deaths. We remember in our prayers their loved ones, those that feel lost and indeed bereft. And for a moment in silence, we bring them to mind as we reflect on what is happening in our society and the violence that seems to be being engendered. For a moment in silence, we join with others in churches this day who will be praying for those who have lost loved ones. Oh, gracious God, in time may they find healing, and may we as part of your church be an agency of such healing, and individually and corporately agents of reconciliation, as all of goodwill seek to bring an end to the violence which is so scarring our life and society. We pray too for others of whom we know and whose needs are different. There are those who are in hospital. There are those in our residential homes and nursing homes, both dependent on the care of others, and we give thanks for those who do that caring. We pray for those elderly but frail and at home who also require the support of others, their families or agencies. We pray too for our young people as they seek to find their way in life, the opportunities that are before them, the excitement of young life. May they be guided by the promptings of your Holy Spirit. There are those who are lonely and anxious, fearful for what the days will bring, those who are ill and for whose illness, sadly, there is no cure. And for them and for their families, we ask also the blessing of your peace. And always we remember those, not just in recent days, but who have lost loved ones in the past months, weeks, days, or even years, who live with that sense of absence. May they too find a source of comfort and support. We pray too for those who govern us and who lead the nations, people of power and of influence. Sadly, a power sometimes unchecked, which has led to oppression and cruelty, and indeed war. And we reflect on societies becoming increasingly divided, hostile one to the other, where we should be working for a common good. And so may the leaders of the nations be granted wisdom and humility, with a desire to serve rather than to be served. We pray for those caught up in war and violence throughout this your world, in so many countries, in the Middle East, in Ukraine, but in other nations too. The devastation that war and violence creates, the loss of homes, of communities, and of life. And we pray for a greater peace in this your world, and that we in our own lives may be agents of such peace. And always we remember in our prayers those no longer with us, but whose love we were privileged to know and to receive. May we never think them far from us, for we share a communion, a fellowship with them still, through the mystery of that fellowship and communion that we have in you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue our worship with the giving of our offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, in your name we dedicate this, our offering, and all our offerings of our time, our talents, and resources, praying that they may be symbols of our commitment to live in your ways and to work for the signs and the growth of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in whose name we pray together now and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. In 468, Son of God, Eternal Saviour, Source of Life and Truth and Grace. In 468.
Thank you.
And now go in peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and all whom you love this day and always.